$3 an hour for Absolute Radio backstage behind the John Peel tent in Mourner's dressing room with Nick. Yes. Hello, Nick. Yes.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm enjoying the environ.
Yeah.
How are you? Did you design this yourself?
I did. I was going for like the prison insane asylum vibe, and that's what I came up with.
So how was that? Your first Glastonbury, I believe?
Is it? Awesome. Yes, it was. It was great. You know, playing early, sometimes you have little apprehensions of how it's going to go, but we were happy.
And you sort of mentioned that the weather, while you're on, usually you get the weather, and then as soon as you leave, the heavens open, which...
We are on a roll right now where when we play, the sun is usually out, or at least it's not raining, and then right when we finish, it usually starts raining.
Yeah.
So this is the fourth show in a row, literally, where it's done this, and it's raining right now.
You're like the rain makers.
Yeah.
Yeah. So a big sound from a four-piece. We walked past the tent, and huge sound from a four-piece. You've got to be pleased with that. You really fill a room.
Yeah. I mean, we're noisy. Yeah, I think with Vince and I, we were raised in church, and Pentecostal church is all about emotion. So usually, I think we were programmed in a bad way to think like the louder the better. Even when you're arguing, if you're louder, that means you're right. So,
you ever thought about handing out the hymn books? That'd be pretty good, wouldn't it?
What's that?
The hymn books.
Like, oh yeah, yeah. We used to deviate and kind of do our own things. Yeah, we would do like Stand By Me and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like,
obviously, you guys were raised in church. You spent a lot of time around the Pentecostal church. Do you see a gig as being a sermon, so to speak?
Yeah, in some ways. I mean, the difference between us and, like, you know, well, I think, you know, religion or politics or art, any of it, when it's done right, it's not forced. I think with us, it's like, it's definitely more of a message of like, feel. We're just not telling you what to feel.
You know,
we're telling you to do. We're just not telling you, you know, what to do.
No.
You know, just feel and do whatever, just as long as you're doing something.
It's just like, love, isn't it?
We hate apathy, and we hate, like, you know, the songs that we, you know, I've said a million times, we're not trying to be indie or trendy or clever or anything. We're trying to, you know, write songs that people can sing.
Yeah.
I'm all about accessibility. I think good music is not just for the cool kids, it's for everybody. That's 16 to 60, and I think that, you know, people need to get out of this closed-minded mentality of, like, selective or elitism. Like, it's one of the reasons why hip-hop and pop are kicking rock and roll's ass right now.
Yeah.
It's because it's all about come one, come all, and everybody wants to sing it. And I think with us, it's kind of the message we're just trying to get across. We don't, you know, just feel something.
You mentioned on stage Johnny Cash.
Mm-hmm.
How much of an influence is he?
Huge. A lot of the old soul, I call him, you know, the old soul era. You know, he's very much like my father, very much like how my grandfather was before he passed. Like this, they meant what they said, and they did it, and they weren't mean people, but they were potent people. I mean, like, if they said it, you know, that's what was happening. And I got a chance, when I moved to Nashville, we went to the Cash family farm and got to hang out with the son, and sat in his old rocking chair. Obviously, this is after, like, Johnny had passed, but, like, it's another era, man, that we need to reinsert some of those mentalities back into music of just, like, you know, the classic Johnny Cash middle finger, you know.
He should do some sort of photo shoot with you. Everybody just giving.
Have you seen that picture? His finger is so big.
It's a long finger, isn't it?
It's like, what the
heck? It's finger picking, like, isn't it?
Yeah, we would have to do some photoshopping. I'm like, I'm 5'8". I got like women's hands.
It's a good pointer. Obviously, you're good friends with Kings of Leon. You sort of grew up with him a little bit?
I've known him for several years now.
Yeah.
I grew up with him, but like, Caleb and I met, we became friends, and then Jared and I are actually close. We've been, you know, if we're in the same city, we're usually, you know, trying to get in trouble somewhere. Yeah.
Well, you said, because I mean, when you were in on Absolute Radio's Hometime show with Jeff, you mentioned that you even got like hand-me-downs from Caleb. Or,
yeah,
is that
Jared,
guitar pedals and guitars?
No, like literally clothes.
Literally clothes.
When I moved to Nashville, I was homeless. I used to live in my car, so like, if they were in town, like, I'd either stay at, you know, Caleb's house, or they would, you know, make sure I was eating and stuff like that, and then. Later, Jared and I met, obviously, and got closer later, you know, when he would be getting rid of clothes, like, whatever would fit, like, you know, he'd let me kind of go through
it
first.
It's not a bad sort of hand-me-down to have a rock star.
Yeah,
sort of.
I mean, Jesus, like, if you gotta get it from somebody, that's a good place to get it. And I try to do the same thing, like, we, you know, on tour, you wear the same thing. I mean, I have, like, 70 white t-shirts, so it's like, but when you do get stuff, or you get companies that give you stuff, like, I try to have the same mentality
and
give it to, you know, family or people that I know that need it,
you know,
as opposed to trying to be cool and like just hoard everything.
Just hoard it.
Yeah,
it's
just,
a big cupboard full of hats that you're never going to wear.
Yeah.
sort of, sorry guys, I've got a lot of notes because I'm trying to plan where I am. Are you pleased with how Britain as a whole has sort of reacted to your music?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, when we play in London, especially, you know, when we play in the UK in general, but especially in London, like, I'm very vocal about thanking. You know, we're humbled and grateful, and I come across as an asshole and a very bravado personality, but that's just because that's what you want me to do anyways.
Yeah. You're a front man, for crying out loud.
Yeah, but I mean, it's genuinely very humbling, and we're very grateful, you know, that, you know, people heard a song and reacted to it.
Yeah.
You know, they could have heard that same song and not, and we wouldn't be here. So yeah. It's, you know, I think all musicians, no matter from the top to the bottom, need to remember it's because of someone else that you're here, not yourself. So.
Are you going to be sticking around today to check out some of the acts, or have you
not
got
at
any
all.
Whisked
we're,
away?
We're off. We're doing some shows with Morrissey, and then we have a few of our own shows, and so we have a lot of traveling ahead of us. We've played with Miles Kane before, so it was good that he was right after us, and then our buddies, Cage the Elephant, who Jordan and Zach are bass player and guitar player from Bowling Green, Kentucky, and that's where they're from, and they're right across the hall here. So it was good that this worked out the way it did, because the people that we wanted to see, we got to. So
how do you sort of deal with the food over here? Is it sort of like, are you looking for your mutton barbecues, is it good old Kentucky food, or?
Well, I mean, those boys probably. We all live in Tennessee now, and I'm from Ohio, so I'm like a Midwest. I'm a steak guy. So if you give me, I could eat
South America, maybe. You need a big Argentina.
Yeah, either like
or
Argentina,
something.
Maybe Japan, Brazil. If not, you guys do steak okay. Burgers, not so much. But I'm learning, you know, like the curry over here is great, and our Indian food in the States pretty much sucks. But
yeah.
We do better Mexican. It's probably a tie on Chinese. Your chocolate is not good. I know you guys are so proud.
Oh, because we think your chocolate sucks as well. So it's kind of.
I thought ours was good. I came over here. Everybody's like, "Oh, we're gonna kick your ass." It was terrible. And then I went to Brussels, and I was like, "Finally, the promised land."
The promised land.
I almost went into a coma. Like, the guys were probably drinking, and I was like,
"Is that your vice? Is that your
dude?" I'm a whore. I'm a chocolate whore. So it's not very rock and roll at all, but you give me whiskey and then chocolate. And
give
I'm
you
fine.
You and a vending machine together is a beautiful partnership. I
definitely.
Guess. Well, thank you very much, Nick Mourner.
Awesome.
Absolute Radio.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.